Thank you very much. You are so kind. I hope you are doing well. I hope you are well prepared for all the talks and you are not hungry. I had breakfast. Somebody hungry in the auditorium? No, that's good. So maybe some of you stayed healthy with the breakfast. So I did eat myself some muesli. Maybe some other ones were going for some more sweet or maybe even to go for some egg and sausages. I think also many of us did already enjoy a cappuccino, and now our body is digesting. I'm also pretty much sure that some of you did take something else before or after the breakfast, and maybe it might be a medication. So why we are taking medications, and what are our expectations? We have a very simple expectation. We have some headache, we take a pill, and we expect within a few minutes to maybe 1 hour, we are feeling better. We have high blood pressure, we are taking a capsule to decrease the blood pressure. And we're taking maybe some other medicine to treat bacteria. We might take tablets, we might take medication by inhalation, or we might also need sometimes injection. In all cases, we are expecting to move illness very quickly to health. So this sounds very simple. But however, in reality, it's much more difficult. So if we look, what could be happen is that the drug molecule is not taken up by the body. So we need to inject it. It's not taken up if you give it by capsules or powder or tablets. And it might also be that our drug molecules are easily excreted via the kidney or they are metabolized by the liver. So we have maybe a half-life for a few minutes, but we would like to have an effect maybe over several hours to 1 day. So it's rapidly leaving the body and deactivated. And another problem that in reality, in many cases, we have a very poor control of the drug location. So we would like to treat the headache, but the drug might work something else. Or we might to treat an eye disease. However, the drug might also be present in the heart and in the liver. And combined with the toxicity of the drug, which many drugs have, we might actually observe heart problems after taking eye droplets. So therefore, a low control of distribution combined with a high toxicity is a serious problem in drug therapy. And for example, many cancer therapies have to be stopped due to serious side effects of the drug molecule. So can we do better? Can we improve such systems? We could make new molecules, but we can also maybe change the delivery weight and the localization by galenics. Did anybody hear about galenics so far? Almost nobody. So, okay. So, makes it more difficult. So, galenics, what is galenics? It's actually my profession. It's the science and art of formulation. What we are doing is we take the drug molecules that come from the chemistry and we take some additional substances. It could be polymers, it could be lipids. And we do some processing. We make particles, implants, something else, tablets, to make a delivery systems. And by making a good delivery systems, we can change the system and improve the therapy. You know already such drug delivery systems. You know tablets. You know also maybe pellets, which can be filled in capsules, for example, which are in the millimeter range. And we have also some material which is quite smaller. For example, for inhalation, we need to go down to the micron range. And 1 micrometer is about 1,000 part of the millimeter. If we cut the micrometer again in 1,000 pieces, we end up in the nanometer range. And we need these very, very small materials to make IV injections, to inject something in the blood to prevent blockage of the capillaries. So we have a size range which covers centimeter to the nanometer range. What are the features of our molecules we would like to deliver, we would like to improve? Some of them are quite small. Other ones are medium-sized, for example, that's an insulin molecule. And other ones are quite big, for example, proteins or DNA or RNA. We have also quite different features of our drug substances with respect to solubility. Some of them easily dissolve in water, others do not, but they dissolve in lipids. However, we have also many molecules which are like a brick stone. They do not dissolve in water, they do not dissolve in lipid. And you can imagine it's very hard to get a brick stone into the body in the right place. And we have some technology which actually work for this. And we have big trouble because many molecules are quite sensitive. So we use organic solvents, we use high temperature, we use shear stress, and many substances, for example proteins, are inactivated or degrade under such circumstances. So we have a lot of problem to somehow make this concept, this simple concept, the reality. What do we need to control if we speak about to improve drug delivery? We need to control, of course, the amount. If we do not have enough drug, we have not effect. If we have too much, we have serious side effects. And we need to control the location. If we would like to treat a headache, we would not like to have the drug in the stomach. And we need to control the time. So some diseases demand maybe a few hours. Other diseases, we have a delivery over days, weeks, and maybe for you, surprisingly, even months to maybe 1 or 2 years. So quite a also different time range. So what is the concept for controlled drug delivery systems? In many cases, we would like to achieve a constant release. And why? Because as a result of this constant release, we have a constant level. So we have enough drug to have an effect, but we have not enough to have serious side effects. And we would like to stay in this range all the time, for example, for several weeks to several months. So this is a concept. If we design such system, what is the typical use of such systems? For example, if you would like to treat local infection, imagine you have an infection in your bone marrow. If you give the drug just as a tablet, only a few amount will reach this the bone marrow. We can make an implant or give particles locally to have a good treatment. Or we could treat brain cancer more efficiently if we place such things directly into the brain. Or we could inject such material to treat arthritis if we inject such particles into the joints or to treat periodontitis. And we have many applications and a medical need for some organs which are quite important also for communication. And these organs are the eyes and the ears. So what is with the eyes? Professor Wistens, he is the head of the eye department at our hospital. He's saying we urgently need new systems to make drug delivery more efficient. We need systems that the drug stays for longer time at the desired location. So what is the problem? We have many diseases in the forefront of the eye, and normally we are treated by eye drops. Does anybody take eye drops? Maybe some of you, okay. So how many times you are using it per day? 3 times? 4 times? Okay. So what is your imagine how long a drug molecule stays on the eye? Actually, it's few seconds to a few minutes. So to have a constant delivery and a constant concentration, we would have to use these eye drops maybe 10 times an hour, but nobody is doing it. So we need new systems that the drug stays for much longer time on the eye. And we have, many people have problems with a disease which is called macular degeneration. We have very sensitive cells which are dying if the people become older. And as the end of this disease, the people got blind. Since a few years, we have new medicine, new molecules which are able somehow to return this disease to a better state. However, they have to be injected into the eye, into the inner part of the eye, in a monthly basis. And of course, nobody would like to have a high frequency of injections into the eye. Yeah? It's good that we have these new drug molecules, but of course it would be much better if you would just have 1 injection per year, or maybe 1 injection every 5 or 10 years. And we need to develop systems which make this as a real drug delivery system. We have a similar situation in the ear. The huge unmet needs of patients with hearing disorders have been recognized. It's now considered important. It matters. It affects the quality of life because we need hearing to also to communicate. And what is the problem? Sometimes people have a sudden hearing loss. Sometimes we are losing the hearing capacity as a result of drug treatment, for example, cancer drugs. And of course, also people got older and more people have an age-related loss or decrease of the hearing capability. The ear itself, the inner ear, is localized within a bone shell. It's very hard to get there, and there are many barriers, and there are also efficient systems to clear out drugs over there. So it's very hard to get there, and you are easily out of the game. So what we did together was we looked for implants, and he was placing, Professor Plontke was placing implants in the middle ear to treat some disease, sudden hearing loss in the inner ear, the cochlea. Right now, we are working on new systems, so we are making very, very small implants which are implanted directly into the cochlea. And of course, this is a very sensitive organ, and also the operation is quite challenging and difficult, but I think we are on a good way. So in addition to the local effects, so where the release of the drug is also the location where the drug acts, we have many examples also where we might have a controlled release over weeks to months, but the drug is actually acting on a different location. And we have such systems on the market for breast cancer and prostate cancer. And breast cancer and prostate cancer are the most commonly cancers in men and women. And we have also such systems to treat schizophrenia, diabetes, and other diseases. If we now look what we have on the market, we have more or less a quite limited selection of the materials. So there are biodegradable polymers called PLA or PLGA, polylactide. You use the same material maybe also for 3D printing or cosmetic surgery. And it's a good material, however, it has also some disadvantages. So it's a polymer, it degrades to small parts, and these small units, they are quite acidic. We have a low pH, and this causes trouble. Because the drug, which we would like to deliver, might already degrade before it's released. And of course, this is not what we would like to have. Or we have a non-linear release. So as I mentioned, we would like to have a linear release, a constant release, but quite often we have a non-linear release. So this is what we would like to achieve, a constant release, and this is what we have sometimes in reality. So this is actually a commercial drug on the left side, which is used to treat schizophrenia. And as a matter of fact, the patients have to take tablets because you have no release within the first 2 weeks. However, the patients do not take the tablets, and we have a higher risk of suicide, 3 times more. On the right side, you see actually the blood levels of peptide drugs which are used to treat prostate and breast cancer. And if you just look for this scale, here we have a 10, here we have a 10,000. You need maybe 10 or less than 10. And so we have 1,000 times the drug which we need. And this is far away from this constant release. So we have a burst release, too much drug is released at the beginning. So we need to develop alternative materials. With our colleagues from chemistry, we are working on such materials. So we have new polymers, which are biodegradable, which are hydrophilic, which are more lipophilic. We can change the other states, like we can make it solid or liquid, and we can bind the drug to the polymer or just mix it. We are also using oleochields, which are cheap, much cheaper to produce, and we have controlled release over several weeks to several months. So there are some new systems in the pipeline. That's the good news. Many times we are not able to get a cure with local delivery. So sometimes we have several locations, for example, metastatic cancers. We need to have something else. We need to have a drug taxi, which drives the drug to the location. And if we speak about this, we are again in the nano range. We need nanoscaled drug delivery systems. So something which we can inject into the blood, and the taxi drives the drug to the tumor or to the site of inflammation. How can we design such system? How the drug and the carrier knows where to go? You can make a polymer, which is long circulating. You can maybe bind some other things to this polymer, and you can also make sure that the drug is only released from the polymer in the tumor environment. And here's just one example. Here you see If you use a free drug, there's almost nothing in the tumor. If you use our polymer systems, we have a much higher concentration in the tumor. And actually, we were able to cure resistant tumors in a preclinical model. Here you see that the tumor, this is the mass of the tumor, and it's declining, and we have total cure. And it was a cooperation with our partners from Halle Medical Department and our partners in Prague. However, in our attempts to improve our taxi systems, we also did see that sometimes the truck, the taxi, is driving the wrong way. It's leaving the highway and going something else. And what we observed, surprisingly, was that our taxi did drive to the ovaries and to the adrenals. So both are organs which are responsive for steroid, for hormones. They are very important, of course. And we do not understand this effect so far. We have some knowledge, but not enough. And our findings, in the meantime, have been confirmed also by French scientists. So we need to understand it, to prevent it, or to make new delivery systems to cure specifically diseases in the ovaries and adrenals. So I'm already close to the end of my talk. So the take-home message, you might never hear about Galenix, but it enables a better drug therapy by changing the kinetics and distribution of drugs. It might affect your life. And I think we already have seen progress which have been made by this Galenix approach, make medicines work. But I think also you recognized, if you look for some of the market products and the story with the adrenals and the ovaries, that a lot more needs to be done. I would like to thank all my current members and previous members of my group, and my, of course, my cooperation partners. And of course, I thank you very, very much for coming, for listening. And I hope if you now take next time your tablet, you have a little more knowledge and estimation what is behind a tablet or a capsule. So thank you very much for coming and listening.